Canvas on the Hill by W.D. Snodgrass. Up the reputable walks of old established trees they stalk, children of the nouveau riche. Chimes of the tall clock tower drench their heads in blessing.
I don't want to play at your house. I don't like you anymore.
My house stands opposite, on the other hill among meadows, with the orchard fences down and falling. Deer come almost to the door. You cannot see it, even in this clearest morning. White birds hang in the air between over the garbage landfill and those homes thereto adjacent, hovering slowly, turning, settling down like the flakes sifting imperceptibly onto the little town in a water ball of glass. And yet, this morning, beyond this quiet scene, the floating birds, the backyards of the poor, beyond the shopping plaza, the dead canal, the hillside lying tilted in the air. Tomorrow has broken out today. Riot in Algeria, in Cyprus, in Alabama. Aged in wrong, the empires are declining, and China gathers soundlessly like evidence. What shall I say to the young on such a morning? Mind is the one salvation, also grammar? No, my little ones lean not toward revolt. They are the whites, the vaguely furiously driven, who resist their souls with such passivity as would make Quakers swear. All day, dear Lord, all day they wear their godhead lightly. They look out from their hill and say to themselves, we have nowhere to go but down. The great destination is to stay. Surely the nations will be reasonable. They look at the world, don't they? The world's way. The clock just now has nothing more to say.
Cartoon Physics, Part 1, by Nick Flynn. Children under, say, 10. Shouldn't know that the universe is ever expanding, inexorably pushing into the vacuum. Galaxies swallowed by galaxies, whole solar systems collapsing. All of it acted out in silence. At 10, we are still learning the rules of cartoon animation, that if a man draws a door on a rock, only he can pass through. Anyone else who tries will crash into the rock. 10-year-olds should stick with burning houses, car wrecks, ships going down, earthbound, tangible disasters, arenas where they can be heroes. You can run back into a burning house. Sinking ships have lifeboats. The trucks will come with their ladders. If you jump, you will be saved. A child places her hand on the roof of a school bus and drives across a city of sand. She knows the exact spot it will skid, at which point the bridge will give, who will swim to safety, and who will be pulled under by sharks. She will learn that if a man runs off the edge of a cliff, he will not fall until he notices his mistake.
Hope is the Thing with Feathers by Emily Dickinson. Hope is the thing with feathers that perches in the soul and sings the tune without the words, and never stops at all. And sweetest in the gale is heard, and sore must be the storm that could abash the little bird that kept so many warm. I've heard it in the chillest land and on the strangest sea, yet never in extremity It asked a crumb of me.
Memory as a Hearing Aid by Tony Hoagland. Somewhere, someone is asking a question, and I stand squinting at the classroom with one hand cupped behind my ear, trying to figure out where that voice is coming from. I might be already an old man, attempting to recall the night his hearing got misplaced. Front row center at a battle of the bands, where a lot of leather-clad, second-rate musicians, amped up to dinosaur proportions, test drove their equipment through our ears. Each time the drummer threw a tantrum, the guitarist swirled and sprayed us with machine gun riffs, as if they wished that they could knock us quite literally dead. We called that fun in 1970, when we weren't sure our lives were worth surviving. I'm here to tell you that they were, and many of us did, despite ourselves, though the road from there to here is paved with dead brain cells, parents shocked to silence, and squad cars painting the whole neighborhood the quaking tint and texture of red jelly. Friends, we should have postmarks on our foreheads to show where we have been. We should have pointed ears or polka-dotted skin to show what we were thinking when we hot-rotted over God's front lawn and death kept blinking. But here I stand, an average-looking man, staring at a room where someone blonde in braids with a beautiful belief in answers is still asking questions. Through the silence in my dead ear, I can almost hear the future whisper to the past. It says that this is not a test, and everyone passes.
Acteon by A. E. Stallings. The hounds, you know them all by name. You fostered them from purblind whelps at their dam's teats, and you have come to know the music of their yelps. High-strung Anthe, the brindled Bish, the blue-tick-coated Philomel, and freckled Chloe, who would fetch a pretty price if you would sell, all fleet of foot and swift of scent, inexorable once on the track. Like angry words you might have meant, but do not mean and can't take back. There was a time when you would brag how they would bay and rend apart the hopeless belling from a stag. You falter now for the foundered heart. Desires you nursed of a winter's night? Did you know then why you bred them, whose needling milk teeth used to bite the master's hand that leashed and fed them?
The Death of Allegory by Billy Collins. I am wondering what became of all those tall abstractions that used to pose, robed and statuesque in paintings, and parade about on the pages of the Renaissance, displaying their capital letters like license plates. Truth, cantering on a powerful horse. Chastity, eyes downcast, fluttering with veils. Each one was marble come to life, a thought in a coat. Courtesy, bowing with one hand always extended. Villainy, sharpening an instrument behind a wall. Reason with her crown, and constancy alert behind a helm. They are all retired now, consigned to a Florida for tropes. Justice is there standing by an open refrigerator. Valor lies in bed listening to the rain. Even death has nothing to do but mend his cloak and hood. And their props are locked away in a warehouse. Hourglasses, globes, blindfolds, and shackles. Even if you called them back, there are no places left for them to go. No garden of mirth or bower of bliss. The valley of forgiveness is lined with condominiums, and chainsaws are howling in the forest of despair. Here, on the table, near the window, is a vase of peonies, and next to it, black binoculars and a money clip. Exactly the kind of thing we now prefer. Objects sitting quietly on a line in lowercase, themselves and nothing more. A wheelbarrow, an empty mailbox, a razor blade resting in a glass ashtray. As for the others, the great ideas on horseback, and the long-haired virtues in embroidered gowns. It looks as though they have traveled down the road you see on the final page of storybooks. The one that winds up a green hillside and disappears into an unseen valley where everyone must be fast asleep.
Full Moon by Eleanor Wiley. My bands of silk and miniver momently grew heavier. The black gauze was beggarly thin, the ermine muffled mouth and chin I could not suck the moonlight in. Harlequin in lozenges, of love and hate I walked in these striped and ragged rigmaroles. Along the pavement my footstoles trod warily on living coals. Shouldering the thoughts I loathed in their corrupt disguises clothed, morality I could not tear from my ribs to leave them bare, ivory in silver air. There I walked and there I raged, the spiritual savage caged, within my skeleton raged afresh to feel behind the carnal mesh, the clean bones crying in the flesh.
Please Don't by Tony Hoagland. Please don't tell the flowers. They think the sun loves them. The grass is under the same simple-minded impression about the rain, the fog, the dew. And when the wind blows, it feels so good they lose control of themselves and swab toggle wildly around, bumping accidentally into their slender neighbors. Forgetful little lotus eaters. Solar-powered hydroholics drawing nourishment up through stems into their thin green skin, high on the expensive chemistry of mitochondrial explosion, believing that the dirt loves them. The night, the stars, reaching down a little deeper with their pale albino roots, all Dizzy Gillespie with the utter sufficiency of everything. They don't imagine lawnmowers, the four stomachs of the cow, or human beings with boots who stop to marvel at their exquisite flexibility and color. They persist in their soft-headed hallucination of happiness, but please don't mention it. Not yet. Tell me, what would you possibly gain from being right?
Arrow in the Song by Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. I shot an arrow into the air. It fell to earth. I knew not where, for so swiftly it flew the sight cannot follow it in its flight. I breathed the song into the air. It fell to earth, I knew not where. For who has sight so keen and strong that it can follow the flight of song? Long, long afterward, in an oak, I found the arrow, still unbroke. And the song, from beginning to end, I found again in the heart of a friend.
Cloud Fishing by Phyllis Levin. To fish from a cloud in the sky, you must find a comfortable spot. Spend a day looking down patiently, clear-sighted. Peer at your ceiling where a light dangles. Hook and line could be slipping through. Under the hull of a boat, a fish will see things this way. Looking up while swimming by, a wavering pole's refraction catching its eye. What will you catch? With what sort of bait? Take care, or you'll catch yourself, a fish might say, as inescapable skeins of shadows scatter a net over the face of the deep.
It's The Little Towns I Like by Thomas Lux. It's the little towns I like, with their little mills making ratchets and stanchions, elastic web, spindles, you name it. I like them in New England, America, particularly providing bad jobs good enough to live on, to live in families even, kindergarten, church suppers, beach umbrellas. The towns are real. So fragile in their loneliness, a flood could come along, and floods have, and cut them in two, in half. There's no mayor. The town council's not prepared for this. Three of the four policemen are stranded on their roofs, and it doesn't stop raining. The mountain is so thick with water, parts of it just slide down on the heifers. Soggy, suicidal. In the pastures below, it rains in these towns. And because there's no other way, your father gets in a rowboat so he can go to work.
Sonnet. On being cautioned against walking on a headland overlooking the sea, because it was frequented by a lunatic. By Charlotte Smith. Is there a solitary wretch who hies to the tall cliff with starting pace or slow and measuring, views with wild, hollow and wild eyes its distance from the waves that chide below? Who, as the seaborn gale with frequent sighs chills his cold bed upon the mountain turf, with hoarse, half-utter lamentation lies murmuring responses to the dashing surf? In moody sadness, on the giddy brink, I see him more with envy than with fear. He has no nice felicities that shrink from giant horrors. Wildly wandering here, he seems uncursed with reason, not to know the depth or the duration of his woe.
In School Days by John Greenleaf Whittier. Still sits the schoolhouse by the road, a ragged beggar sleeping. Around it still the sumacs grow, and blackberry vines are creeping. Within, the master's desk is seen, deep scarred by raps official. The warping floor, the battered seats, the jackknife's carved initial. The charcoal frescoes on its wall, its door's worn sill, betraying the feet that, creeping slow to school, went storming out to playing. Long years ago, a winter sun shone over it at setting, lit up its western window panes and low eaves' icy fretting. It touched the tangled golden curls and brown eyes full of grieving of one who still her steps delayed when all the school were leaving. For near her stood the little boy her childish favor singled, his cap pulled low upon a face where pride and shame were mingled. Pushing with restless feet the snow to right and left, he lingered, as restlessly her tiny hands the blue-checked apron fingered. He saw her lift her eyes, he felt the soft hands light caressing, and heard the tremble of her voice, as if a fault confessing. I'm sorry that I spelt the word. I hate to go above you because, the brown eyes lower fell, because you see, I love you. Still memory to a gray-haired man, that sweet child face is showing. Dear girl, the grasses on her grave have 40 years been growing. He lives to learn in life's hard school how few who pass above him lament their triumph and his loss, like her, because they love him.
The Wind Hover by Gerard Manley Hopkins, to Christ our Lord. I caught this morning morning's minion, kingdom of daylight's dauphin, dapple, dawn, drawn falcon in his riding of the rolling level underneath him steady air. And striding high there, how he rung upon the rein of a wimpling wing in his ecstasy, then off, off forth on swing as a skate's heel sweeps smooth on a bow bend. The hurl and gliding rebuffed the big wind. My heart in hiding stirred for a bird, the achieve of, the mastery of the thing. Brute beauty and valor and act, oh, air, pride, plume, here buckle. And the fire that breaks from thee then, a billion times told lovelier, more dangerous, oh, my chevalier. No wonder of it. Sheer plod makes plow down sillion shine, and blue bleak embers, ah, my dear, fall, gall themselves, and gash gold vermilion.
Respiration by Jamal May. A lot of it lives in the trachea, you know, but not so much that you won't need more muscle. The diaphragm, a fist clenching at the bottom. Inhale. So many of us are breathless. You know, like me, kneeling to collect the pottery shards of a houseplant my elbow has nudged into oblivion. What if I sigh and the black earth beneath me scatters like insects running from my breath? Am I a god then? Am I insane because I worry about the disassembling of earth regularly? I walk more softly now, into gardens or up the steps of old houses with impatiens stuffed in their window boxes. When it's you standing there, with a letter or a voice full of solemn news, will you hold your breath before you knock?
Cartoon Physics, Part 1, by Nick Flynn. Children under, say, 10 shouldn't know that the universe is ever expanding, inexorably pushing into the vacuum, galaxies swallowed by galaxies, whole solar systems collapsing, all of it acted out in silence. At 10, we are still learning the rules of cartoon animation, that if a man draws a door on a rock, only he can pass through it. Anyone else who tries will crash into the rock. 10-year-olds should stick with burning houses, car wrecks, ships going down, earthbound, tangible disasters, arenas where they can be heroes. You can run back into a burning house. Sinking ships have lifeboats. The trucks will come with their ladders. If you jump, you will be saved. A child places her hand on the roof of a school bus and drives across a city of sand. She knows the exact spot it will skid, at which point the bridge will give. Who will swim to safety, and who will be pulled under by sharks? She will learn that if a man runs off the edge of a cliff, he will not fall until he notices his mistake.
The Obligation to be Happy by Linda Pastan. It is more onerous than the rites of beauty or housework, harder than love. But you expect it of me casually, the way you expect the sun to come up, not in spite of rain or clouds, but because of them. And so I smile, as if my own fidelity to sadness were a hidden vice, that downward tug on my mouth. My old suspicion that health and love are brief irrelevancies, no more than laughter in the warm dark strangled at dawn. Happiness. I try to hoist it on my narrow shoulders again, a knapsack heavy with gold coins. I stumble around the house, bump into things. Only Midas himself would understand.
For Love by Robert Creeley, for Bobby. Yesterday, I wanted to speak of it. That sense above the others, to me, important, because all that I know derives from what it teaches me. Today, what is it that is finally so helpless, different, despairs of its own statement, wants to turn away endlessly, to turn away. If the moon did not, no. If you did not, I wouldn't either. But what would I not do? What prevention? What thing so quickly stopped? That is love yesterday or tomorrow, not now. Can I eat what you give me? I have not earned it. Must I think of everything as earned? Now love also becomes a reward so remote from me, I have only made it with my mind. Here is tedium, despair, a painful sense of isolation, and whimsical, if pompous, self-regard. But that image is only of the mind's vague structure, vague to me, because it is my own. Love, what do I think to say? I cannot say it. What have you become to ask? What have I made you into? Companion? Good company? Crossed legs with skirt? Or soft body under the bones of the bed? Nothing says anything but that which it wishes would come true. Fears what else might happen in some other place, some other time, not this one. A voice in my place, an echo of that only in yours. Let me stumble into not the confession, but the obsession I begin with now. For you also, some time beyond place or place beyond time, no mind left to say anything at all, that face gone. Now, into the company of love, it all returns.
The Cross of Snow by Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. In the long, sleepless watches of the night, a gentle face, the face of one long dead, looks at me from the wall where round its head the night lamp casts a halo of pale light. Here in this room she died, and soul more white never through martyrdom of fire was led to its repose. Nor can in books be read the legend of a life more benedite. There is a mountain in the distant west that, sun-defying in its deep ravines, displays a cross of snow upon its side. Such is the cross I wear upon my breast these 18 years, through all the changing scenes and seasons, changeless since the day she died.
What It Looks Like to Us and the Words We Use by Ada Limon. All these great barns out here in the outskirts, black creosote boards knee deep in the bluegrass. They look so beautifully abandoned, even in use. You say they look like arcs after the seas dried up. I say they look like pirate ships. And I think to that walk in the valley where Jay said, "You don't believe in God?" And I said, "No. I believe in this connection we all have to nature, to each other, to the universe." And she said, "Yeah, God." And how we stood there, low beasts among the white oak, Spanish moss and spider webs, obsidian shards stuck in our pockets, woodpecker flurry, and I refused to call it so. So instead, we looked up at the unruly sky, its clouds and simple animal shapes we could name, though we knew they were really just clouds. Disorderly and marvelous and ours.
Domestic Situation by Ernest Hilbert.
Maybe you've heard about this. Maybe not. A man came home and chucked his girlfriend's cat in the wood chipper. This really happened. Dinner wasn't ready on time. A lot of other little things went wrong. He spat on her father, who came out when he learned about it. He also broke her pinky, stole her checks, and got her sister pregnant. But she stood by him, stood strong through it all. Because she loved him. She loved him, you see. She actually said that. And then she went and married him. She felt some unique call. Don't try to understand what another person means by love. Don't even bother.
Novel by Arthur Rimbaud. 1. We aren't serious when we're 17. One fine evening, to hell with beer and lemonade, noisy cafes with their shining lamps, we walk under the green linden trees of the park. The lindens smell good in the good June evenings. At times, the air is so scented that we close our eyes. The wind, laden with sounds, the town isn't far, has the smell of grapevines and beer. 2. There you can see a very small patch of dark blue framed by a little branch pinned up by a naughty star that melts in gentle quivers, small and very white. Night in June, 17 years old, we are overcome by it all. The sap of champagne and goes to our head. We talked a lot and feel a kiss on our lips, trembling there like a small insect. 3. Our wild heart moves through novels like Robinson Crusoe, when, in the light of a pale street lamp, a girl goes by, attractive and charming, under the shadow of her father's terrible collar. And as she finds you incredibly naive while clicking her little boots, she turns abruptly and in a lively way. Then, Caventinas die on your lips. 4. You are in love. Occupied until the month of August, you are in love. Your sonnets make her laugh. All your friends go off, you are ridiculous. Then, one evening, the girl you worship deigned to write to you. That evening, you return to the bright cafes. You ask for beer or lemonade. We're not serious when we are 17 and when we have green linden trees in the park.
The Affliction of Richard by Robert Bridges. Love not too much, but how, when thou hast made me such, and dost thy gifts bestow, how can I love too much? Though I must fear to lose and drown my joy and care, with all its thorns I choose the path of love and prayer. Though thou, I know not why, didst kill my childish trust, that breach with toil did I repair, because I must, in spite of frighting schemes with which the fiends of hell blaspheme thee in my dreams, so far I have hoped well. But what? The heavenly key? What marvel in me wrought shall quite exculpate thee? I have no shadow of thought. What am I that complain? That love from which began my question, sad and vain, justifies thee to man.
A Poison Tree by William Blake. I was angry with my friend. I told my wrath did end. I was angry with my foe. I told it not, my wrath did grow. And I watered it in fears, night and morning with my tears. And I sunned it with smiles and with soft, deceitful wiles. And it grew both day and night, till it bore an apple bright, and my foe beheld it shine, and he knew that it was mine, and into my garden stole, when night had veiled the pole. In the morning, glad I see, my foe outstretched beneath the tree.
The New Colossus by Emma Lazarus. Not like the brazen giant of Greek fame, with conquering limbs astride from land to land, here at our sea-washed sunset gates shall stand a mighty woman with a torch whose flame is the imprisoned lightning, and her name, Mother of Exiles. From her beacon hand glows worldwide welcome. Her mild eyes command the air-bridged harbor that twin cities frame. Keep ancient lands your storied pomp, cries she with silent lips. Give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free, the wretched refuse of your teeming shore. Send these, the homeless, tempest-tossed to me. I lift my lamp beside the golden door.
The Negro Speaks of Rivers by Langston Hughes.
I've known rivers ancient as the world and older than the flow of human blood in human veins. My soul has grown deep like the rivers. I bathed in the Euphrates when dawns were young. I built my hut near the Congo and it lulled me to sleep. I looked upon the Nile and raised the pyramids above it. I heard the singing of the Mississippi when Abe Lincoln went down to New Orleans, and I've seen its muddy bosom turn all golden in the sunset. I've known rivers, ancient, dusky rivers. My soul has grown deep like the rivers.
The Tree by Anne Finch, Countess of Winchelsea. Fair tree, for thy delightful shade, 'tis just that some return be made. Sure, some return is due from me to thy cool shadows and to thee. When thou to birds dost shelter give, thou music dost from them receive. If travelers beneath thee stay till storms have worn themselves away, that time in praising thee they spend and thy protecting power commend. The shepherd here, from scorching freed, tunes to thy dancing leaves his reed, whilst his love nymph in thanks bestows her flowery chaplets on thy boughs.
Shall I then only silent be, and no return be made by me? No. Let this wish upon thee wait, and still to flourish be thy fate. To future ages mayest thou stand, untouched by the rash workman's hand, till that large stock of sap is spent, which gives thy summer's ornament, till the fierce winds that vainly strive to shock thy greatness whilst alive, shall on thy lifeless hour attend, prevent the axe, and grace thy end. Their scattered strength together call, and to the clouds proclaim thy fall. Who then their evening dews may spare, when thou no longer art their care, but shalt, like ancient heroes, burn, and some bright hearth be made thy urn.
The Chimney Sweeper, When My Mother Died, I Was Very Young, by William Blake. When my mother died, I was very young, and my father sold me while yet my tongue could scarcely cry. Weep, 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 weep. So your chimneys I sweep, and in soot I sleep. There's little Tom Dacre, who cried when his head, that curled like a lamb's back, was shaved. So I said, "Hush, Tom, never mind it, for when your head's bare, you know that the soot cannot spoil your white hair." And so he was quiet. And that very night, as Tom was a-sleeping, he had such a sight that thousands of sweepers, Dick, Joe, Ned, and Jack, were all of them locked up in coffins of black. And by came an angel who had a bright key, and he opened the coffins and set them all free. Then down a green plain, leaping, laughing, they run and wash in a river and shine in the sun. Then naked and white, all their bags left behind, they rise upon clouds and sport in the wind. And the angel told Tom, if he'd be a good boy, he'd have God for his father and never want joy. And so Tom awoke, and we rose in the dark and got with our bags and our brushes to work. Though the morning was cold, Tom was happy and warm. So if all do their duty, they need not fear harm.
Novel by Arthur Rimbaud. We aren't serious when we're 17. One fine evening, to hell with beer and lemonade, noisy cafes with their shining lamps. We walk under the green linden trees of the park. The lindens smell good in the good June evenings. At times, the air is so scented that we close our eyes. The wind, laden with sound, the town isn't far, has the smell of grapevines and beer. There, you can see a very small patch of dark blue
framed by a little branch, pinned up by a knotty star that melts in gentle quivers, small and very white. Night in June, 17 years old, we are overcome by it all. The sap is champagne and goes to our head. We talked a lot and feel a kiss on our lips, trembling there like a small insect. Our wild heart moves through novels like Robinson Crusoe when, in the light of a pale street lamp, a girl goes by, attractive and charming, under the shadow of her father's terrible collar. And as she finds you incredibly naive, while clicking her little boots, she turns abruptly and in a lively way, then cavatinas die on your lips. You are in love, occupied until the month of August. You are in love. Your sonnets make her laugh. All your friends go off. You are ridiculous. Then one evening, that girl you worshipped deigned to write to you. That evening, you return to the bright cafes. You ask for beer or lemonade. We aren't serious when we are 17 and when we have green linden trees in the park.
In Memoriam, Martin Luther King Jr., by June Jordan. Honey, people murder mercy. USA, the milkland, turn to monsters, teach to kill, to violate, pull down, destroy the weekly freedom growing fruit from being born. America, tomorrow, yesterday, rip, rape, exacerbate, despoil, disfigure, crazy running threat, the deadly thrall appall, belief dispel, the wildlife burn, the breast, the onward tongue, the outward hand deform the normal, rainy riot, sunshine shelter, wreck of darkness, derogate, delimit, blank, explode, deprive, assassinate, and batten up like bullets fatten up the raven greed, reactivate a springtime terrorizing. Death by men by more than you or I can stop. They sleep who know a regulated place or pulse or tide, or changing sky, according to some universal stage direction, obvious like shore-washed shells. We share an afternoon of mourning, in between no next predictable, except for wild reversal, hearse rehearsal, bleach the black long lunging ritual of fright, insanity, more deplorable abortion, more and more.
In, by Andrew Hudgens. When we first heard from blocks away the fog truck's blustery roar, we dropped our toys, leapt from our meals, and scrambled out the door into an evening briefly fuzzy. We yearned to be transformed, translated past confining flesh to disembodied spirit. We swarmed in thick smoke, taking human form before we blurred again, turned vague, and then invisible, in temporary heaven. Freed of bodies by the fog, we laughed, we sang, we shouted. We were our voices, nothing else. Voice was all we wanted. The white clouds tumbled down our streets, pursued by spellbound children who chased the most distorting clouds, ecstatic in the poison.
Please Don't, by Tony Hoagland. Please don't tell the flowers. They think the sun loves them. The grass is under the same simple-minded impression about the rain, the fog, the dew. And when the wind blows, it feels so good, they lose control of themselves and swab toggle wildly around, bumping accidentally into their slender neighbors. Forgetful little lotus eaters. Solar-powered hydroholics, drawing nourishment up through stems into their thin green skin, high on the expensive chemistry of mitochondrial explosion, believing that the dirt loves them, the night, the stars, reaching down a little deeper with their pale albino roots, all Dizzy Gillespie with the utter sufficiency of everything. They don't imagine lawnmowers, the four stomachs of the cow, or human beings with boots who stop to marvel at their exquisite flexibility and color. They persist in their soft-headed hallucination of happiness. But please don't mention it. Not yet. Tell me, what would you possibly gain from being right?
Advice to a Prophet, by Richard Wilbur. When you come, as soon you must, to the streets of our city, mad-eyed from stating the obvious, not proclaiming our fall, but begging us in God's name to have self-pity, spare us all word of the weapons, their force and range, the long numbers that rocket the mind, our slow, unreckoning hearts will be left behind, unable to fear what is too strange. Nor shall you scare us with talk of the death of the race. How should we dream of this place without us? The sun, mere fire, the leaves untroubled about us, a stone look on the stone's face. Speak of the world's own change. Though we cannot conceive of an undreamt thing, we know to our cost how the dreamt cloud crumbles, the vines are blackened by frost, how the view alters. We could believe, if you told us so, that the white-tailed deer will slip into perfect shade, grown perfectly shy. The lark avoid the reaches of our eye. The jackpine lose its knuckled grip on the cold ledge, and every torrent burn as Xanthus once, its gliding trout stunned in a twinkling. What should we be without the dolphin's arc, the dove's return? These things in which we've seen ourselves and spoken, ask us, Prophet, how we shall call our natures forth when that live tongue is all dispelled, that glass obscured or broken, in which we have said the rose of our love and the clean horse of our courage, in which beheld the singing locust of the soul unshelled, and all we mean or wish to mean. Ask us whether with the wordless rose our hearts shall fail us, come demanding whether there shall be lofty or long standing when the bronze annals of the oak tree close.
Sonnets from the Portuguese, 43. How do I love thee? Let me count the ways, by Elizabeth Barrett Browning. How do I love thee? Let me count the ways. I love thee to the depth and breadth and height my soul can reach, when feeling out of sight for the ends of being an ideal grace. I love thee to the level of every day's most quiet need, by sun and candlelight. I love thee freely as men strive for right. I love thee purely as they turn from praise. I love thee with a passion put to use in my old griefs and in my childhood's faith. I love thee with a love I seem to lose with my lost saints. I love thee with the breath, smiles, tears of all my life, and if God choose, I shall but love thee better after death.
Broken Promises by David Kirby. I have met them in dark alleys, limping and one-armed. I have seen them playing cards under a single light bulb and tried to join in, but they refused me rudely, knowing I would only let them win. I have seen them in the foyers of theaters, coming back late from the interval long after the others have taken their seats, and at deserted shopping malls late at night, peering at things they can never buy. And I have found them wandering in a wood where I too have wandered. This morning I caught one, small and stupid, too slow to get away. It was only a promise I had made to myself once and then forgot. But it screamed and kicked at me and ran to join the others, who looked at me with reproach in their long, sad faces. When I drew near them, they scurried away, even though they will sleep in my yard tonight. I hate them for their ingratitude. I, who have kept countless promises, as dead now as Shakespeare's children. You bastards, I scream, you have to love me. I gave you life.
The Affliction of Richard by Robert Bridges. Love not too much, but how? When thou hast made me such, and dost thy gifts bestow, how can I love too much, though I must fear to lose and drown my joy in care? With all its thorns I choose the path of love and prayer. Though thou, I know not why, didst kill my childish trust, that breach with toil did I repair, because I must. And spite affrighting schemes with which the fiends of hell blaspheme thee in my dreams, so far I have hoped well. But what the heavenly key, what marvel in me wrought, shall quite exculpate thee? I have no shadow of thought. What am I that complain? The love from which began my question, sad and vain, justifies thee to man.
El Olvido by Judith Ortiz Cofer. It is a dangerous thing to forget the climate of your birthplace, to choke out the voices of dead relatives when in dreams they call you by your secret name. It is dangerous to spurn the clothes you were born to wear for the sake of fashion, dangerous to use weapons and sharp instruments you are not familiar with, dangerous to disdain the plaster saints before which your mother kneels, praying with embarrassing fervor that you survive in the place you have chosen to live. A bare, cold room with no pictures on the walls. A forgetting place where she fears you will die of loneliness and exposure. Jesús, María y José, she says. El olvido is a dangerous thing.
The Conqueror Worm by Edgar Allan Poe. Lo, 'tis a gala night within the lonesome latter years, an angel throng, bewinged, bedight, in veils and drowned in tears, sit in a theater to see a play of hopes and fears, while the orchestra breathes fitfully the music of the spheres. Mimes in the form of God on high mutter and mumble low, and hither and thither fly, mere puppets they who come and go, at bidding of vast formless things that shift the scenery to and fro, flapping from out their condor wings invisible woe. That motley drama, oh, be sure it shall not be forgot, with its phantom chased forevermore by a crowd that sees it not, through a circle that ever returneth into the selfsame spot, and much of madness and more of sin, and horror the soul of the plot. But see, amid the mimic rout, a crawling shape intrude, a blood-red thing that rise from out the scenic solitude. It rise, with mortal pangs, the mimes become its food, and seraphs sob at vermin fangs in human gore imbued. Out to the lights, out all, and over each quivering form, the curtain, a funeral pall, comes down with the rush of a storm. The angels, all pallid and wan, uprising, unveiling, affirm that the play is the tragedy Man, and its hero, the Conqueror Worm.
A Poison Tree by William Blake. I was angry with my friend. I told my wrath did end. I was angry with my foe. I told it not, my wrath did grow. And I watered it in fears, night and morning with my tears. And I sunned it with smiles, and with soft, deceitful wiles. And it grew both day and night, till it bore an apple bright. And my foe beheld it shine, and he knew that it was mine, and into my garden stole, when night had veiled the pole. In the morning, glad I see, my foe outstretched beneath the tree.
Memory as a Hearing Aid by Tony Hoagland. Somewhere, someone is asking a question, and I stand squinting at the classroom, with one hand cupped behind my ear, trying to figure out where that voice is coming from. I might be already an old man, attempting to recall the night his hearing got misplaced. Front row center at a battle of the bands where a lot of leather-clad second-rate musicians amped up to dinosaur proportions. Tests drove their equipment through our ears. Each time the drummer threw a tantrum, the guitarist whirled and sprayed us with machine gun riffs as if they wished they could knock us quite literally dead. We called that fun. In 1970, when we weren't sure our lives were worth surviving, I'm here to tell you that they were. And many of us did despite ourselves, though the road from there to here is paved with dead brain cells, parents shocked to silence and squad cars painting the whole neighborhood the quaking tint and texture of red jelly. Friends
We should have postmarks on our foreheads to show what we were thinking. We should have pointed ears or polka-dotted skin to show what we were thinking when we hot-rodded over God's front lawn and death kept blinking. But here I stand, an average-looking man, staring at a room where someone, blonde in braids, with a beautiful belief in answers, is still asking questions. Through the silence in my dead ear, I can almost hear the future whisper to the past. It says that this is not a test, and everybody passes.
The Minx by Toy Derricotte. In the backyard of our house on Norwood, there were 500 steel cages lined up, each with a wooden box roofed with tar paper, inside two stories, with straw for a bed. Sometimes the minx would pace back and forth wildly, looking for a way out, or else they'd hide in their wooden houses. Even when we'd put the offering of raw horse meat on their trays, as if they knew they were beautiful and wanted to deprive us. In spring, the placid kits drank with glazed eyes. Sometimes the mothers would go mad and snap their necks. My uncle would lift the roof like a god who might lift our roof, look down on us, and take us out to safety. Sometimes one would escape. He would go down on his hands and knees, aiming a flashlight like a bullet of light, hoping to catch the orange gold of its eyes. He wore huge boots, gloves so thick their little teeth couldn't bite through. "They're wild," he'd say. "Never trust them." Each afternoon when I'd put the scoop of raw meat rich with eggs and vitamins on their trays, I'd call to each a greeting. Their small, thin faces would follow, as if slightly curious. In fall, they went out in a van, returning sorted, matched, their skins hanging down on huge metal hangers, pinned by their mouths. My uncle would take them out when company came and drape them over his arm, the sweetest cargo. He'd blow down the pelt softly, and the hairs would part for his breath and show the shining underlife, which, like the shining of the soul, gives us each character and beauty.
I am offering this poem by Jimmy Santiago Baca. I am offering this poem to you, since I have nothing else to give. Keep it like a warm coat when winter comes to cover you, or like a pair of thick socks the cold cannot bite through. I love you. I have nothing else to give you, so it is a pot full of yellow corn to warm your belly in winter. It is a scarf for your head to wear over your hair, to tie up around your face. I love you. Keep it. Treasure this as you would if you were lost, needing direction in the wilderness life becomes when mature. And in the corner of your drawer, tucked away like a cabin or hogan in dense trees, come knocking and I will answer, give you directions and let you warm yourself by this fire, rest by this fire, and make you feel safe. I love you. it's all I have to give, and all anyone needs to live, and to go on living inside when the world outside no longer cares if you live or die. Remember, I love you.
To Be of Use by Marge Piercy. The people I love the best jump into work head first without dallying in the shallows and swim off with sure strokes, almost out of sight. They seem to become natives of that element, the black, sleek heads of seals bouncing like half-submerged balls. I love people who harness themselves, an ox to a heavy cart, who pull like water buffalo with massive patience, who strain in the mud and the muck to move things forward, who do what has to be done, again and again. I want to be with people who submerge in the task, who go into the fields to harvest and work in a row and pass the bags along, who are not parlor generals and field deserters, but move in a common rhythm when the food must come in or the fire be put out. The work of the world is common as mud. Botched, it smears the hands, crumbles to dust. But the thing worth doing well done has a shape that satisfies, clean and evident. Greek amphoras for wine or oil, Hopi vases that held corn, are put in museums, but you know they were made to be used. The pitcher cries for water to carry, and a person for work that is real.
Friendship After Love by Ella Wheeler Wilcox. After the fierce midsummer, all the blaze has burned itself to ashes and expires in the intensity of its own fires. There come the mellow, mild St. Martin days, crowned with the calm of peace, but sad with haze. So after love has led us, till he tires of his own throes and torments and desires, comes large-eyed friendship. With a restful gaze, he beckons us to follow, and across cool, verdant vales we wander, free from care. Is it a touch of frost lies in the air? Why are we haunted with a sense of loss? We do not wish the pain back, or the heat, and yet, these days are incomplete.
Ozymandias by Percy Bysshe Shelley. I met a traveler from an antique land who said, two vast and trunkless legs of stone stand in the desert. Near them, on the sand, half sunk, a shattered visage lies, whose frown and wrinkled lip and sneer of cold command tell that its sculptor well those passions read, which yet survive stamped on these lifeless things, the hand that mocked them and the heart that fed. And on the pedestal these words appear, my name is Ozymandias, King of Kings. Look on my works, ye mighty, and despair. Nothing beside remains. Round the decay of that colossal wreck, boundless and bare, the lone and level sands stretch far away.
Undress by Ruby Robinson. There is an ash tree behind this house. You can see it from our bedroom window. If you stare at it for long enough, you'll see it drop a leaf. Stare at it now, you said, and notice the moment a leaf strips away from its branch, giving a twirl. Consider this. The ash tree unclothes itself Octoberly from beside our bed, fingering the curtain. Observe the dark candles at the top of that tree, naked and alert, tending to the breeze. A sheet of ice between the rooftops and this noiseless sky has turned the air inside out. Black veins of branches shake against the blue screen on which they hang. Small mammals are hibernating in pellets of warm air underground. But in spite of the cold, this ash tree does not shy from shrugging off its coat, sloping its nude shoulders to the night. So, you said, undo, unbutton, unclasp, slowly remove, let down your hair, breathe out. Stand stark in this room until we remember how not to feel the chill. Stand at the window, lift your arms right up like a tree. Yes, like that. Watch leaves drop.